Just for those of you that don't know, Aviva is one of the biggest insurance companies in the world. We run approaching half a trillion in assets under management. We were formed in 1696. And I've watched over the last decade as the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative has really come of age. For me, it is a decade. I recall a 10-year ago ISAR meeting in a room not so far away where this came up as a discussion point. And so I'd like to use this opportunity to congratulate everybody here, including particularly Anthony, but not just Anthony. There's a number of other people who I won't mention, but you know who you are. The progress is fantastic. I've watched as we've gone from no exchanges in 2009 being signatories to now over 70. I can see now guidance from 38, 39 stock exchanges on how companies should disclose. And crucially, I can see now stock exchange listing rules come through. And we've gone from two or three in 2009 to now something like 16 today, having disclosure requirements mandated. That for me is the gold standard. So I just want to say congratulations for everything you've achieved with the quartet. So that's UNCTAD, the PRI, the Global Compact, the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, and whoever it was, I forgot, if there was anyone. Thank you, UNEP. Sorry, Eric. So can I just pause and ask everyone to clap the progress that's been achieved so far? Three and a half minutes is to give you a sense of demand that I'm seeing from our clients, which is where ultimately the half a trillion comes from, to capture the market inefficiency conversation and then focus on market failure. In terms of market demand, we have seen in the last 2 years alone 120% growth in the number of institutional investors asking us questions about ESG. That's our clients. We run pensions, we run all sorts of other institutional money. 120% growth in the number of questionnaires. Within those questionnaires, 700% growth in the number of questions they are asking us that cover environmental, social, and governance issues. That is enormous growth, I'm sure you would recognize. In addition, in terms of the crucial investment consultants, these are the people that sit between fund managers and the asset owners, every single one of our tier one, the biggest investment consultants, Mercer's, Aon, Hewitt Baker & Woodrow, I could go on, all of them now challenge us in terms of how we scrutinize ESG issues and how we run money. So for those of you sitting here at the exchange level thinking this debate is going to go away, absolutely it is not. In addition, the Market and Financial Information Directive in Europe has been amended, probably will require every investment advisor across Europe from the end of next year to ask the end investor if they have any ESG preferences. That is 2 trillion in the market. We've already seen a market of 23 trillion in the institutional space. We're going to have 2 trillion added from the retail space very, very soon. This is going to be a further revolution. So whilst we've come a long way in the last 10 years, whilst it's great that we've made so much progress, the demand is getting huge. This is not going to go away. Market inefficiency now. We know that we can exploit the information that we get from these corporate reports to generate alpha. In other words, to exploit the information advantage that exists here. We know that there are market inefficiencies. There are a whole series of reasons why those market inefficiencies exist. But our job as an active fund manager is to use this data to outperform. And the good news is the evidence, whether you're on the sell side, whether you're one of our fund managers, or whether you're in the academic community, the evidence consistently performs to companies that disclose this data and do well, perform better in the long term as good investments. Now, why should that surprise us? These are companies that simply look after their employees better, look after their customers, comply with their regulatory provisions, look after local communities, and don't abuse the local environment. Why should that be such an astonishingly good business model? That is clearly how businesses should work. So it is now a proven fact that ESG, good management of ESG, leads to better returns and lower risk. But the key point is it does not equate to the delivery of the SDGs. The Sustainable Development Goals are very different to the environmental and social governance issues that we look at, which are material. Let me be very clear. If we're looking at corporate data to maximize an information advantage, we're looking to exploit a market inefficiency. We want to know what are the material issues that are going to lead to an information upside. In this case, it's how does the SDG hit the company's cash flows? It's how is the environmental issue manifesting in the report and accounts? And because markets are poorly structured, because there are market failures, because there is something called externalities, it is routinely the case where doing the wrong thing does actually lead to a market failure, and that is the role of government to correct. So we look to exploit the data, but companies that are managing this issue well does not necessarily lead to better SDG performance. So there's two challenges I'd like to leave on the table. One, in relation to the high-level political forum that the United Nations run, I had the pleasure of reading the Sustainable Development Goal report back in the summer. In a 45-page report, there is only one paragraph on companies, and in my view, that paragraph isn't quite right. The goal 12.6 is looking at all large companies, yet the response is from a KPMG study that only looks at the world's top 250. So the UN Statistical Division needs to gear up its own competence in monitoring and measuring corporate performance. And in closing, I mentioned at the beginning a very positive note, how far progress has come. And I've watched as the WFE was invited to attend in 2009 and took the opportunity to come but didn't speak. I've watched as WFE has become the chair of the panel. That's a wonderful transition. I'd like to just applaud WFE too. And I've watched as IOSCO has now gone from being an attendee to actually a keynote speaker. And it's IOSCO's Growth in Emerging Markets Committee that excites me the most. I know that's a strange phrase to say, but in I would like to commend you, Paul, Ranjit Singh, and Ashley Ian Alder for the work that you've been doing in the Growth in Emerging Markets Subcommittee. If you could focus on the listing rules conversation, we need to generate comparable, consistent global data that corrects that market failure. I know you're focused on that, and thank you very much.